know that the Chachamim made a rule that for holidays and festive occasions, we are obligated to praise Hashem through Hallel. We have the chapters in Tehillim that are Hallel. We say Hallel, Pesach, Shavuos, Sukkot. But even on the rabbinic holiday of Hanukkah, which is Midrabanan, we say a full Hallel for 8 days. Now, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, we do not recite Hallel, and that the Gemara already explains why. Since God is deciding who will live and who will die, so the dominant emotion of Yomim Noraim is one of fear and trepidation, so the unrestrained joyousness of Hallel is not appropriate. But the big question the Gemara asks is, why do we not recite Hallel on Purim? Purim is a very happy day, a salvation of the Jewish people. Why don't we say Hallel? And you can't answer it's only a rabbinic holiday, because obviously it's not worse than Hanukkah. In fact, Purim is earlier than Hanukkah. Purim is in the Tanakh, even though it's rabbinic technically, and Hanukkah is post-biblical. So the Gemara gives three answers for why we don't say Hallel on Purim. Answer number one is, we don't say Hallel on Purim because reading the Megillah is the substitute for Hallel. By reading the Megillah and acknowledging Hashem as saving us, that is the Hallel of, meaning we do say Hallel on Purim. The Hallel we say on Purim is reading the Megillah. That's answer one. Answer two is, we don't say Hallel on miracles that happen in Chutz La'aretz. We only say Hallel on miracles that happen in Eretz Yisrael. So the obvious question is, what type of answer is that? What about Pesach? The Hallel of Pesach, everything happened in Mitzrayim. So the Gemara says, well, that was on the way, meaning to say, the miracles in Chutz La'aretz that are the Emtsa'i to bring you to Eretz Yisrael, you say Hallel. But a self-contained Golos miracle that's not bringing you back to Eretz Yisrael, no Hallel for that. And the third answer, which actually from the Yom HaTzimut perspective is quite interesting, is we only say Hallel where as a result of the miracle we no longer face the danger that we were facing. Hanukkah. We no longer faced Greek rule because we overthrew the Greeks. We established a Jewish sovereign state. But in the case of Achashverosh, what happened here? Even after the miracle of Purim, we are still the slaves of Achashverosh. What's going to stop him, or the subjects of Achashverosh? Huh? What's going to stop him from having a Haman the next day, some other Haman? Right, Steve Bannon, some other guy like that, whatever it would be. Which means, in other words, unlike Hanukkah, where, as a result of the wars of Hanukkah, we overthrew Malchut Yavan, here we did not overthrow Malchut Achashverosh, and therefore we are still in a state of vulnerability. Now, some have tried to use that argument, and maybe this deserves a share of its own, as an argument against Hallel on Yom HaTzimut. You know, this is at least in the States, this is a very, very burning question. Every rabbi who's interviewing for a position in an Orthodox synagogue, whether it's right or left, has to be able to give a detailed answer. What is your position of Hallel on Yom HaTzimut? And then the rabbi has to kind of discreetly ask, well, what is it that you want me to say? You know, and then figure it out one way or the other. But the truth of the matter is there are conflicting analogies here. On one hand, the Hanukkah story is a very strong argument in favor of Hallel. Because the Rambam writes beferish that the Hallel of Hanukkah is not because of the miracle of candles, or even though that miracle happened. The Hallel of Hanukkah is the reestablishment of Jewish sovereignty in the land of Israel. Now, keep in mind that the Hasmonean dynasty eventually was not a righteous dynasty. They were Hellenist in many, many ways. It was not a from government. And yet the Rambam said that warranted Hallel. That is actually a fairly strong Yom HaTzimut argument, that in spite of government, religious, not religious, etc. However, some use a counter-argument, and they look at the Purim story by saying, well, in Purim, since we are still facing the original dangers, we're not out of the hot water. So some have pointed out that Yom HaTzimut was the beginning of a war. It was not the end of any particular war. It was the beginning of a massive war that, to some degree or another, is continuing. And that's why some are mechalek between Yom Yerushalayim and Yom Hazeh. Yom Yerushalayim is a davar mesuyam. That's a definitive thing. We have, you know, Yerushalayim and the Harabai. Okay, I don't want to address that. All I'm saying is that third answer and the contrast with Hanukkah is actually, putting aside ideology and politics, is actually a major halachic text on this. Okay. The Shulchan Aruch actually uses answer number one. Megillah is Hallel. Based on answer number one, the Me'iri says a very unusual halacha. Me'iri says, if you are stranded on a desert island, right, your ship got shipwrecked on Purim, or before Purim, and you don't have a Megillah with you, but you have your trusty Siddur, the Me'iri actually writes, you are mechuyav to say Hallel with a bracha on Purim, because the only reason you don't say Hallel is because Megillah takes the place of Hallel. If you don't have a Megillah, you got to say Hallel. That's what the Me'iri says. But the Mishnah Berurah writes that we don't paskin like the Me'iri, that not only is Megillah a substitute for Hallel, but Megillah on Purim is the only way you can do Hallel. You can't do Hallel through Hallel. You can only do Hallel through Megillah. Now, why should that be? Why should a surrogate Hallel be better than a real Hallel? So Rav Huttner says the following idea. Rav Huttner says, it's a very ingenious thought. He says that the Hallel that praises Hashem for his miracles has to take the same form as the miracle itself. Pesach represents what we call nes nigla, open, obvious miracle. Hashem changes the laws of nature. You have the 10 plagues, you have Kriyas Yamsuf. So, because we are commemorating the open revelation of God's miracles, we praise Hashem in an open and obvious way, through Hallel. Purim, as we know, the Megillah itself doesn't even mention the name of Hashem. In Purim, there is actually nothing supernatural that happens at all. If you didn't have eyes of faith, you could chalk it up to all sorts of coincidences. The fact that Achashverosh kills Vashti, which makes room for Esther to become queen, well, kings killed their wives all the time. That was not an unusual thing. Esther gets chosen. Somebody has to get chosen. Mordecai happens to overhear an assassination plot. Haman doesn't know Esther's nation, and therefore she's positioned to frustrate his plan. Beautiful novel. Beautiful story. All the pieces fit together. But I don't see miracles here. I don't see anything beyond the laws of nature. So Purim is a very, very important lesson. Purim is the idea of learning to see Hashem even when his presence is not obvious.